Hi, welcome to Miss Corrigan's science class. Today we're going to be learning about the animal kingdom as part of our classification unit for Year 7 science. The first thing we need to identify is what is an animal. Now, you guys know that an organism is a living thing, according to Mrs. Greff, but to classify a living thing as an animal, you need to realize that they have a similar cell structure. Now, we briefly talked about cell structure in last lesson. I just want you to remind you that cells are the building blocks of life. Like every single thing is made up of either one cell or lots of cells. And they look something like this in animals. Now you can see that there's lots of bits that you probably won't be able to pronounce, like endoplasmic reticulum. You don't need to worry about those. I'm going to get you to focus on one thing that is present and two things that are absent from animal cells. Number one, they have a nucleus. Now a nucleus is this purple thing in the middle. It carries out the instructions, tells the cell what to do, and animal cells have this. What's missing is there's no cell wall. Come on, mouse, work with me, there you are. No cell wall, just a cell membrane around the outside, and no chloroplasts. Now, chloroplasts are special organelles which catch light and turn it into food for the plant. For plants, I should say, because we're not dealing with a plant, we're dealing with an animal here. Now, what this means is that plants can't do this special thing called photosynthesis. Instead, they have to eat to get their food, like this cow or buffalo. Now, traditionally, we've always taught that animals have two major groupings. They either are vertebrates, which means they have a backbone, or they're invertebrates, which means they're all these creatures and the many varied forms which don't have a backbone. Now, scientists have recently decided this isn't correct. The vertebrae and invertebrate aren't true phyla. Instead, they're actually 35 animal phyla. And here's an image. And if you look at that, you'll see here's the chordates, or what we traditionally think of the vertebrates. They only make up one little phyla of all this other variety of life. Let's start to learn about some of them. We're not going to learn all 35. We're just going to learn about 9 of them. Okay, I'm going to start at the simple end of the scale. Simple animals don't have highly organized structures like us humans do. They just have a very basic structure, such as porifera. Porifera are sea sponges. Now, sea sponges means they're marine, they're found in the ocean. You can see that this brain sponge is living under the ocean. They feed by filtering out tiny little particles from the water, which means they're filter feeders. And here's a diagram that shows how that happens. So here's my mouse, yep. So the pores go in through here. The pores let water in. You can see it can flow in there. And then these tiny little structures all through the sponge that can catch the food out of the water. And then it comes out the top. They have lots and lots of water to let this water pass through. And you can see this in this sea sponge up here. And sometimes they live in clumps like this and look like a bunch of chimneys. You might know a famous sponge, SpongeBob SquarePants. Okay, here's another group that's relatively simple. They're called the Cnidarians. Now, it's pronounced Cnidarians. The C is silent. These guys have a hollow and soft body. And the layers of the body are very, very thin. And because of that, they don't need any specialized organs to help them function. They take food in and pass it out through the one opening, which is pretty gross. And they actually have tentacles, which have these special cells called stinging cells. Now, these stinging cells can fire shots of toxin when activated. So if you look at this diagram here, here's A. Your stinging cell is ready to be fired, and actually it's just been triggered there. It's indicated by that little orange bit. This is someone's skin or something like that. And then all of a sudden it causes a chemical reaction to happen inside the stinging cell, which causes this bit to shoot out into the skin and release all the toxin into the skin. And that's how those stinging cells work. And depending on the creature, depends on how bad it is. Now, these cnidarians include things like box jellyfish. These guys have very nasty venom in their stinging cells. Sea Anemone, or Nemo's home. Something called a Portuguese man of war, which is a very scary jellyfish because you can probably see these really long tentacles. They can stretch a long, 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 long way. So they can catch lots and lots of fish and just drift across the ocean. And coral. And I just like that turtle, so that's why I included that picture. Right, time for another simple group called echinoderms. Actually, they're not as simple as some of the other organisms that we've been looking at. They're starting to have specialized layers and structures compared to the sponges and jellyfish. Now, how you pronounce this word is echinoderm. These guys generally have a soft body with a simple internal skeleton. They have skin, and I use the term loosely because it's not skin like our skin, that is rough and often sort of spiny. And the body has a five-part pattern that gives them what we call radial symmetry. Symmetry means that you can cut it in half and you'll get a mirror image. It's balanced on either side. So if we look at this coral, sponge, there's no way we can cut that and have a symmetrical a mirror image on either side. We could take something like a mammal, like this goat, and there's only one way we can cut it to get a mirror image on either side. If we were to cut it, and that's from nose to tail, if we were to cut it straight across its belly like this, it wouldn't be a mirror image. It would be a head and a tail, so it just wouldn't work. Now this guy is what we call radial symmetry because there's multiple directions that you can cut it in where you would get a mirror image. Okay, let's move on. Now, this group includes sea stars, sea urchins. You can see some sea urchins, the little round spiny ones there. There's another couple of pictures of sea urchins. They don't necessarily have to have these big long spines, but if they do, like these guys, you do need to watch out because they can really injure you if you mess with them. And finally, sea cucumbers. Now, this guy down here gives you a good idea why they're called sea cucumbers. He literally looks like a cucumber sitting at the bottom of the ocean, but they're not always that sort of plain, boring looking thing. It could be this quite interesting purple organism here. Okay, time to move into a slightly more complex group of organisms called the annelids, and I've put a picture up, so straight away, hopefully you recognize that organism. I've put it up because I want you to realize that it's made up of lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of little segments. All those sort of bands around its body are individual segments. And what happens in each of those segments, they have a certain group of organs that repeat over and over and over again. They have soft bodies, no exoskeleton, and lucky them, they have a mouth and an anus, so they don't have to poop out their mouths. Instead, the food that they eat goes through, gets digested in their crop and gizzard, and the nutrients get absorbed into intestines, and it comes out the rear end. This includes earthworms, as you can see, leeches, and once you go in year 9 camp, I want you to be aware of that, leeches can suck. Here's our second of three groups of worms, and they're called nematodes. These guys aren't as nice as the previous group. Now, they're also known as roundworms. These guys, like the previous worms, have soft bodies, but they aren't segmented. They don't have an exoskeleton, and they're worm-shaped, like this guy. Now, again, they have a mouth and an anus, like the previous group of worms, so things just pass right on through them. They don't have to stop, digest the food, excrete it, eat again, digest the food, excrete it. It's just a continuous cycle, like us. These guys are usually parasitic. Now, parasitic means that they live off your body. For example, the threadworm lives inside our intestines and actually will reproduce inside our guts. So it's important to make sure you keep good hygiene when you're using the bathroom. That's part of the reason. They don't just live in your intestines, though. They are found in other parts of the body, and there's another lovely parasite sucking on someone's eye. Two major groups, threadworms, which tend to be the small ones. You can see these guys are about a centimeter long, and the larger cousins, the roundworm. Either way, you do not want them. Okay, on to our last group of worms, and these guys are called platyhelminthes. So platyhelminthes. Again, these guys can be parasitic, but they're also known as flatworms. And here's a picture to show you why. They've got soft, flat, and their bodies are usually, but not always, segmented. But here's an example of a segmented one. You can see the individual segments. You can see that they're really, really flat. They don't have an exoskeleton. And unlike the other two groups of worms, these guys don't have an anus. So they do have to feed, digest, and excrete out of their mouths and then feed again and do the cycle again. They are parasitic. For example, you can probably imagine this mouth on the top of this guy. He uses it to hook onto your intestinal walls and feed off you. So they're not pleasant to have either. They include tapeworm, which is what this is a picture of, a fluke, and this is an example of an unsegmented one. It's just one continuous body, and it's normally found in the liver. And you can see it's really, really thin. You can actually see right through it, just about. Something called a tubularia. Now, this one's not parasitic. You would definitely see it coming. They're beautiful, colorful marine worms. Okay, let's move on to a group called molluscs. Now, these guys live both on the land and in the water, and let's see how. Most of them will have a shell. So here's a land. Well, actually, you also get water snails. But most of them have a shell. You can see the shell here on the back of this snail. They have a soft, unsegmented body. You probably know that from stepping on the snails and slugs after they come out in the rain. And no legs. But they can have something called tentacles. So this is a giant Pacific squid. Even though they don't have legs, they have a strong foot, which is just a special muscle that helps them move, regardless of whether they're slithering around on the land or swimming through the ocean. They include oysters, which make pearls, octopuses or octopi, scallops, slugs, and of course, snails. And most of them are quite yummy. Though I would need a slug. Yuck. Okay, I think this is our last group of what would be considered an invertebrate before we move on to the old-fashioned group of vertebrates. And it's arthropods. Now, arthropods are animals that have their bodies divided into segments. Here's an example. You can see that there's lots and lots of segments that make up this, I think it's a crayfish. They have an exoskeleton. Now, what's an exoskeleton? An exoskeleton is a body, is a skeleton that's on the outside of its body, and it actually helps protect it from predation. They have paired and jointed legs. Now, we haven't seen many legs yet. These other creatures have all been getting around in other ways. So when we zoom in, we can see that each leg comes in pairs, and you can see that they've got lots and lots of joints going along them. Most of them will have antenna sticking out the front of the body there. And these groups include centipedes, yuck, spiders, also yuck, but I found a cute one. These two groups, of course, can be quite toxic. Crabs, ants, grasshoppers, and moths. And there's a giant atlas moth. Okay, on to the last group. This is traditionally thought of as the vertebrates, but in fact, it should be called chordata. Now, if you're a chordate, you have a nerve cord running down your back. Here you go. So you can see the nerve cord running down the back. These guys are all bilaterally symmetrical, which means they've been cut in half in only one direction. And they have internal skeletons. Now they include fish, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals. Hopefully that gives you a good introduction to the world of animals. See you in class. You will have some work to complete relevant to this.